Now I'm going to turn to our next guest, Lenny Poon. Mary was a witness to history. She lived over 8 decades, so she saw quite a bit in her lifetime. She lived through the indignities of Jim Crow and segregated America, particularly in the South. She lived through the riots in Washington in many cities throughout the U.S. in the 60s, and it was a very tumultuous period in the U.S. history when civil rights was burning in the hearts and minds of many Americans, African Americans primarily. And after the 60s, there was a concern that in the government that, well, we really don't understand what's going on in our cities, what's going on in the inner city, and we should, you know, so the government thought we needed to talk to psychologists and people who knew something about the mind and the unconscious and human motivation. But there weren't any minority psychologists around for the government to ask. And it turns out that that social upheaval in the 60s somehow landed on Mary's desk. Somehow, we talk about the universe, somehow this issue landed on her desk of like, well, there are not enough minority psychologists are in the country to help us understand ourselves, basically. And Lenny, maybe you can talk about that because I think you had some thoughts about that.
Well, thank you. Well, I'm sure that there's many personal stories that Mary touch our lives. I guess there's just no way that we're going to forget Mary at all, whatsoever. She's going to live forever. And I guess the things that I want to talk to you about, both of them as personal. The first one is Kitty talked about the various powers. And one lesson that was taught to me was perseverance, how to stick with it. And perhaps I can tell my personal stories on this particular thing, is that I was first funded by NIMH in 1988. I remember those dates because that was an easy, what I would say, easy grant to get at that time. And I think Barry Libowitz, somebody we all know that's associated with NIMH and with Mary, called me one day saying that, well, NIMH has some money, and if you have a good proposal and you have a good chance of funding. Well, I jumped on it right away because that's not something that you hear every day. I didn't know Mary at the time, but I was fairly new at the University of Georgia at the time, and I pulled together faculty members, as many of us studying aging, from different departments, thinking that, well, there is something that of quality that NIMH may be interested in. And if we work hard at it, and perhaps we would have a chance of getting some money to get going. Well, all of us gave up our Christmas vacation that year. We worked around the clock, submitted the proposal, and the area that we wanted to work on was living long and living well. And at that time, we were very much interested in studying what we call expert survivors, those people who's 100 years old and older, cognitively intact, and still living and vibrant in the community. Mary would be one of those people if she had lived to be 100. Well, we got that grant the first time, but when you study living long and living well, it's not so easy to stay within one discipline. There's a little bit of this and that, and I think for all of us, we think we know whether you're a bench type biologist or a psychologist. And so the issue of interdisciplinary research, which is, I believe, the theme of this particular conference is about. Well, Mary at that time was at NIMH, and she heard that we had gotten this grant, and one of the first persons that I heard from was Mary. And Mary really talked my ear off, and I'm not so sure I really appreciated what she had to say, but I appreciate this more and more every year I've been a researcher. And on this particular project, it's more than 20 years. It's funded by NIMH, it's funded by NIA. And for those of us who work across disciplines, it's not, and especially as a project PI, it's not so easy to work across discipline. Even though NIH or NIMH talk about interdisciplinary research, I don't think they are used to really how to do it. And this is where Mary comes from and really made a big difference in what I've been doing for the last 20 years. This particular project started in 1988, and we are at the end of a particular program project in 2009, so it persevered for more than 20 years. What Mary did for me was being a sounding board, essentially listen to my gripes in terms of working across disciplines. And the types of things that we worked on is perhaps far from caregiving to some extent, closer to bench research. The types of work we do is we look at longevity genes in terms of how genetics contribute to well-being and longevity. We look at Alzheimer's disease, the relationship between neuropathology and neuropsychology. We look at what we call functional capacity, is that how do people live in a very vibrant way in the face of frailty? And how do you define frailty? And what sort of disciplines are appropriate in describing these phenomena? We also talk about the human psyche, as Rick talked about. What about your experiences over a lifetime? And how do these experiences impact what you're doing now and what you're thinking? How do you cope? How do you go about doing things in the face of adversities? Well, talking to Mary periodically and hearing her point of view in terms of how to work with people, when it comes to issues and problems that to me it was very difficult to resolve, she tend to come up with some solution, calling on friends of Mary so that we can talk things through, or maybe acting as an intermediary so that some solutions can come through. Now, it really takes a lot of wisdom, a lot of experience, a lot of trust on human nature to think that one can do this. And from this standpoint, I'm very, very grateful. Her wisdom really helped me grow as a researcher.